You're listening to the audio production of Undaunted, Overcoming Doubts and Doubters by Kara Goldin, founder and CEO of Hintwater, published by HarperCollins Leadership and read by Kara Goldin.
If I can do it. When you're the youngest of five kids, you can easily get lost in the family shuffle, which I did a lot. But you can also learn to fend for yourself, which I did eventually. And ultimately, you can achieve more than anyone might have expected of you. I never thought I would become a leader, run a company, or do anything particularly great for that matter. But when an executive at one of the world's largest beverage companies told me no one would want my unsweetened flavored water, something clicked. I decided to prove him wrong. And I did. This is the story of how I overcame a seemingly endless series of no and you can't and it's impossible to create a unique product, build a thriving company, compete with some of the biggest beverage companies on the planet, and live a life filled with rich experience and constant learning. Today, my product, Hintwater, is the number one flavored water in the United States, and Hint is an iconic brand loved by millions of customers. In this book, I share the lessons I've learned about how to get things done instead of letting real or imagined obstacles stop me in my tracks. The story starts when I was a little kid, but don't worry, this book isn't an autobiography. It's part business, part life lessons, and it's all about the most important things you need to know to be a successful entrepreneur. I call myself an accidental entrepreneur because I came to the world of startups on a different path than many other entrepreneurs. Founding a company was never my goal. I didn't go to business school. I was in my mid-30s when I founded Hint. I had held a number of media and tech jobs, lived in New York and San Francisco, got married, and had kids. Then, like many other people in the early 2000s, I discovered that kicking the diet soda habit and drinking more water helped me lose weight and get healthier. But I learned I could only drink so much plain water before I got bored, so I threw some slices of fruit into the pitcher to make it tastier. That was the start, but I wasn't the first person to put fruit in water or try turning unsweetened flavored water into a product. I was, however, the first to create a successful product while others made compromises that led them astray. I let my passion and commitment to making a great product be my guide, and I stayed focused on what mattered most about the product, taste. I started Hint in 2005 with my husband Theo. At the time, enough consumers were making the move away from sugary and diet-sweetened drinks to bottled water that the large beverage companies, as well as a few entrepreneurial brands, started to include the word water in the name of their newest sweetened drinks. Brands like Vitamin Water attempted to give consumers the feeling they were making a healthy choice, when actually they were getting more of the same. Hint, by contrast, made water taste great without turning it into a sweet, soft drink. No sugar, no diet sweeteners, no preservatives. At first, I wasn't confident I could get the message across in this confusing, highly competitive marketplace, but I wanted to show people that drinks could taste great without having to taste sweet. I didn't anticipate how technically difficult it would be to turn what I made in a kitchen into a product that went on the shelf in a store. Everyone in the business told us we would have to use preservatives or other chemicals to ensure the product had a reasonable shelf life. I refused to make that compromise. I asked Theo to research the issue, and after weeks of phone calls and visits to other bottlers, he told me, "There's no way to get the taste you want and still have enough shelf life to distribute this product around the country." Theo assumed this was the end of our young project. I wasn't willing to quit so easily. "Well, what can we do?" I asked. "We could have a product with a very short shelf life that we deliver locally out of our Jeep in a limited area in San Francisco." "Perfect. That's what we'll do. We'll find out what people think of the product and if it's worth trying to solve this problem." We went ahead with confidence, but on the inside, I was filled with doubts about whether we could pull this off. We started to distribute the product to local stores, achieving some positive responses from consumers and retailers. It gave me enough encouragement to begin networking with industry people to see if I could find someone who could advise us about the shelf life issue. When I'm facing problems I can't solve on my own, this approach, reaching out and asking questions, learning as much as I can, digging into the problem rather than running away from it, proved invaluable for getting Hint to where it is today. Through one of those weird 6 degrees connections, I was put in touch with a senior executive at Coca-Cola. Somehow, in the back of my mind, I figured this top leader of the most famous beverage maker in the world could solve our problem. Just like that. I called the exec at his office in Atlanta. He had no obligation to take my call, yet he was cordial and engaging. I told him about our unsweetened fruit-infused water and why I had started the company, how we had gotten good distribution in local natural food markets like Whole Foods, but that we were up against an issue we couldn't solve, shelf life. He launched into a long discourse on the technical issues involved, bottling and preservation, additives, transport, and warehousing. And he told me about some of the many past efforts related to the shelf life issue that had failed. He seemed to know everything and everybody. He used technical jargon and business lingo that went way over my head. The longer he went on, the more I thought it was over, that my company could never succeed as anything but a nice little side business. When the exec finished with his discourse, I felt defeated and more discouraged than ever. I have no idea what I'm doing. I know nothing about this industry. This is all way beyond me. Why did I ever get involved in this in the first place? I was ready to throw in the towel. I even asked him, "Why don't you just take over my company? I don't care if you pay me anything. I just want to get this product category out there, and you seem to have the resources to take on the challenge." "Listen, sweetie," he chuckled, "I've been in this business a long time. There's one thing I know. Americans want sweet drinks. Sure, you might sell your fruit drink in places like San Francisco, but outside of your friends in Marin County, no one really wants unsweetened drinks." All I heard was "sweetie." Did he really call me sweetie? It hit me then that people like him were so deeply invested in sugary and diet-sweetened drinks that they would never do what I was trying to do. Sweet was all they knew, and sweet drinks were all they wanted to sell. That was our big and very real advantage over them. We had the commitment, the understanding, and the passion for a new approach. If only we could solve the technical and business problems. I realized the Coca-Cola executive did not have the answers I was looking for. I thanked him genuinely because he had given me valuable perspective and insight into not only what I didn't want to be, but also what we were up against. Over the next 2 years, we built an early base of passionate fans of our product. And we expanded distribution. We incrementally improved the product shelf life with a variety of expensive and proprietary methods. Then we had a breakthrough. We came up with our own solution in a way no one could have predicted without help from any industry insiders that enabled Hint to grow, widen distribution, win over more and more consumers, and confound industry heavyweights. Today, Hint is a $150 million plus company. Our product is distributed in all 50 states, and we are the kind of brand known for products that make the healthy choice the most amazing choice. Now I spend a good deal of my time telling the Hint story at live events, in the media, on my website, and in my podcast, Unstoppable with Kara Goldin. I am constantly amazed at how curious people are about how I started and built the company. Many want to create their own enterprises or further their careers within their companies. Everybody wants to find a way to live according to their values, both in their work lives and their personal lives. In this book, I tell the Hint story, not for its own sake, but as a way to offer insight and practical guidance on these issues. If I had to boil down the message to a single word, it would be the book's title, Undaunted. That is the quality that, above all, is necessary to achieve success in creating an endeavor you could proudly call your own. We all have doubts about our capabilities. I certainly did. My dad let his doubts derail his entrepreneurial ambitions. I refuse to. We all run into doubters who are too willing to tell us why we will never achieve what we envision. The sugar soda executive dismissed me. Instead of giving up, I chose to take inspiration from that conversation. We can't change the way of the world. What we can do is look our doubts and doubters in the eye and refuse to be stopped by them. It's not about high IQ, elite credentials, super skills, or any of those other traits we often convince ourselves we must have but are afraid we don't. I wrote this book not because I want to hold myself up as the ideal model, but because everybody needs a little encouragement and advice to help them push away the doubts and doubters and achieve everything they believe they can. If my story proves anything, it's that if I can do it, you can too. I submitted the manuscript for this book to Harper Leadership right before a novel coronavirus turned the world upside down. New York, second home to my company and family, quickly emerged as the epicenter of the pandemic. I considered making changes to incorporate this once-in-a-century event into Undaunted, but decided to let it remain as is. No one at Hint knew this pandemic was coming, but we've been fortunate that the things we did to build a strong, adaptable business, along with selling through multiple channels of trade, are also allowing us to adapt quickly and successfully to consumers' needs. I hope that some of the stories I've shared in Undaunted will help its readers find the courage and strength to chart their own course forward and upward as we emerge from these difficult times. Chapter 1, Open a Lot of Doors. I grew up in Scottsdale, Arizona, right next to Phoenix, in view of Camelback Mountain. My four siblings were always busy with school and sports and part-time jobs. My dad traveled a lot for business, and when he wasn't working, he was coaching baseball or football. When I was in kindergarten, my mom took a job working retail at a local department store and pursued arts and crafts projects on the side. So I was kind of on my own, not neglected or ignored, just independent. If I had a dominant trait as a kid, it was persistence. You have to be persistent when you're the youngest of five. If I wanted something, I had to figure out how to get it. Sometimes I had to argue, pester, or fight for it. Like those bright green pants with colored lifesavers printed on them I saw in a store window. My dad kept saying I didn't need them, and I kept pestering him to buy them for me until he finally came around. "Kara," Dad would say, "you always think that no means maybe and maybe means yes." I drove him crazy sometimes, but he got a kick out of my unwillingness to give up. Mark Twain, who was also known as a feisty kid, said something similar about his mother. My mother had a good deal of trouble with me, but I think she enjoyed it. I did not give up easily on my interests, even when things got difficult. My best events in gymnastics were the vault and the uneven parallel bars. I wasn't great at them, but I kept at it. I broke every toe and both feet, some of them more than once, but that never stopped me. My friends and family got used to seeing me on crutches, and my mom and I spent a fair amount of time in the emergency room together. "Maybe you could be a little more careful, Kara," she would ask, but she never told me to stop. I was curious and asked a lot of questions. I liked to hang out with my friends, and I always wanted to learn their stories. I would rain questions on them and their parents. "Where did you guys move from? What brought you to Scottsdale? What do you do?" I would get so engrossed that my mom would have to call and remind me to come home for dinner. Throughout my life, especially when I haven't been certain about my next step, I've asked questions. I was particularly curious about my dad. He worked for the Armour Food Company, which was later acquired by Conagra, the big food conglomerate. He had dreamed of being an entrepreneur himself, but ended up taking the corporate job to support the family. I remember going with my mom to pick him up at the Phoenix Sky Harbor International Airport after he flew in from a business trip. There was only one terminal back then and no security, so I could run right up to the gate to meet him as he came off of the plane. On the drive home, he'd vent his frustrations about working for a big company and not being recognized for his contributions.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.